area of great traffic. And in this garden, perched on the capitals and balustrades, lying on the dry leaves of the flower beds, climbing on the trunks of the trees or on the drain pipes, motionless on their four paws, their tails making a question mark, seated to wash their faces, there were tiger cats, black cats, white cats, calico cats, tabbies, angoras, Persians, house cats and stray cats, perfumed cats and mangy cats. Marco Valdo realized he had finally reached the heart of the cat's realm, their secret island. And, in his emotion, he almost forgot his fish. It had remained, that fish, hanging by the line from the branch of a tree, out of reach of the cat's leaps. It must have dropped from its kidnapper's mouth at some clumsy movement, perhaps as it was defended from the others, or perhaps displayed as an extraordinary prize. The line had got tangled, and Marco Valdo, tug as he would, couldn't manage to yank it loose. A furious battle had meanwhile been joined among the cats to reach that unreachable fish, or rather to win the right to try and reach it. Each wanted to prevent the others from leaping. They hurled themselves on one another. They tangled in midair. They rolled around, clutching each other. And finally, a general war broke out in a whirl of dry, crackling leaves. After many futile yanks, Marco Valdo now felt the line was free. But he took care not to pull it. The trout would have fallen right in the midst of that infuriated scrimmage of felines. It was at this moment that, from the top of the walls of the gardens, a strange rain began to fall. Fish bones, heads, tails, even bits of lung and lights. Immediately, the cat's attention was distracted from the suspended trout, and they flung themselves on the new delicacies. To Marco Valdo, this seemed the right moment to pull the line and regain his fish. But before he had time to act, from a blind of the little villa, two yellow, skinny hands darted out. One was brandishing scissors, the other a frying pan. The hand with the scissors was raised above the trout.
He's going, what is this trout, right?
The frying pan was thrust under it. The scissors cut the line, the trout fell into the pan, hand, scissors, and pan withdrew, the blind closed, all in the space of a second. Marco Valdo was totally bewildered.
391.
Are you also a cat lover? A voice at his back made him turn around. He was surrounded by little old women, some of them ancient, wearing old-fashioned hats on their heads. Others, younger, but with the look of spinsters, and all were carrying in their hands or their bags packages of leftover meat or fish, and some even had little pans of milk. Will you help me throw this package over the fence for those poor creatures? All the ladies, cat lovers, gathered at this hour around the garden of dry leaves to take the food to their protégés. Can you tell me why they are all here, these cats? Marco Valdo inquired. Where else could they go? This garden is all they have left. Cats come here from other neighborhoods, too, from miles and miles around. And birds as well, another lady added. They're forced to live by the hundreds and hundreds on these few trees. And the frogs, they're all in that pool, and at night they never stop croaking. You can hear them even on the eighth floor of the buildings around here. Who does this villa belong to anyway? Marco Valdo asked. Now, outside the gate, there weren't just the cat-loving ladies, but also other people. The man from the gas pump opposite, the apprentices from a mechanic's shop, the postman, the grocer, some passers-by. And none of them, men and women, had to be asked twice. All wanted to have their say, as always when a mysterious and controversial subject comes up. It belongs to a marquesa. She lives there, but you never see her. She's been offered millions and millions by developers for this little patch of land, but she won't sell.
What would she do with millions? An old woman all alone in the world. She wants to hold on to her house, even if it's falling to pieces, rather than be forced to move.
It's the only undeveloped bit of land in the downtown area. Its value goes up every year. They've made her offers. Offers! That's not all. Threats, intimidation, persecution. You don't know the half of it. Those contractors. But she holds out. She's held out for years. She's a saint. Without her, where would those poor animals go?
392.
A lot she cares about the animals, the old miser. Have you ever seen her give them anything to eat? How can she feed the cats when she doesn't have food for herself? She's the last descendant of a ruined family. She hates cats. I've seen her chasing them and hitting them with an umbrella. Because they were tearing up her flower beds. What flower beds? I've never seen anything in this garden but a great crop of weeds. Marco Valdo realized that with regard to the old Marquesa, opinions were sharply divided. Some saw her as an angelic being, others as an egoist and a miser.
393.
It's the same with the birds. She never gives them a crumb. She gives them hospitality. Isn't that plenty?
Like she gives the mosquitoes, you mean? They all come from here, from that pool. In the summertime, the mosquitoes eat us alive, and it's all the fault of that Marquesa.
And the mice? This villa is a mine of mice. Under the dead leaves, they have their burrows, and at night, they come out. As far as the mice go, the cats take care of them.
Oh, you and your cats. If we had to rely on them,
why? Have you got something to say against cats?
Here the discussion degenerated into a general quarrel. The authorities should do something. Confiscate the villa, one man cried.
What gives them the right? Another protested.
In a modern neighborhood like ours, a mouse nest like this, it should be forbidden.
Why, I picked my apartment precisely because it overlooked this little bit of green.
Green, hell. Think of the fine skyscraper they could build here.
Marco Valdo would have liked to add something of his own, but he couldn't get a word in. Finally, all in one breath, he exclaimed,
"The Marquesa stole a trout from me."
The unexpected news supplied fresh ammunition to the old woman's enemies, but her defenders exploited it as proof of the indigence to which the unfortunate noblewoman was reduced. Both sides agreed that Marco Valdo should go and knock at her door to demand an explanation.
All right, so now the next movement in our story, write it down. He catches his trout. He follows the cat who has stolen his trout. And in the process, he comes to this interesting garden that sits kind of in the middle of all these skyscrapers, and there's cats everywhere. While the cats are all trying to get to the trout that's kind of hung up, from out of a window comes a woman that we're going to hear about, who's kind of like this recluse type of woman. She's got a lot of money, but she's kind of a miser, and she's the one that will take his fish. She'll cut the string. In the meantime, all these people show up. And so you have this interesting exchange that goes on, first of all about the cats, then about the land, this space. By the way, for those of you that know the film Up, and you know at the beginning about this debate about somebody should get rid of their house and give it away so that a big skyscraper can be built. This image tracks back to a story like this very famous image where there's this debate, and then finally it's about this woman. And then the suggestion is, why don't you go talk to this old woman about the fish that you lost? Again, we're always making predictions about what's going to happen next.
It wasn't clear whether the gate was locked or unlocked. In any case, it opened after a push, with a mournful creak. Marco Valdo picked his way among the leaves and cats, climbed the steps to the porch, knocked hard at the entrance. At a window, the very one where the frying pan had appeared, The blind was raised slightly, and in one corner, a round, pale blue eye was seen, and a clump of hair dyed an undefinable color, and a dry, skinny hand. A voice was heard asking, "Who is it? Who's at the door?" The words accompanied by a cloud smelling of fried oil. "It's me, Marchesa, the trout man," Marco Valdo explained. "I don't mean to trouble you. I only wanted to tell you, in case you didn't know, that the trout was stolen from me by that cat, and I'm the one who caught it. In fact, the line..."
394.
"Those cats. It's always those cats," the Marchesa said from behind the shutter with a shrill, somewhat nasal voice. "All my troubles come from the cats. Nobody knows what I go through. Prisoner night and day of those horrid beasts, and with all the refuse people throw over the walls to spite me." "But my trout, your trout. What am I supposed to know about your trout?" The Marchesa's voice became almost a scream, as if she wanted to drown out the sizzle of oil in the pan, which came through the window along with the aroma of fried fish.
"How can I make sense of anything with all the stuff that rains into my house?"
"I understand, but did you take the trout or didn't you?"
"When I think of all the damage I suffer because of the cats, ah, fine state of affairs. I'm not responsible for anything. I can't tell you what I've lost, thanks to those cats who've occupied house and garden for years. My life at the mercy of those animals. Go and find the owners. Make them pay damages. Damages? A whole life destroyed. A prisoner here, unable to move a step."
"Excuse me for asking, but who's forcing you to stay?" From the crack in the blind, there appeared sometimes a round, pale blue eye, sometimes a mouth with two protruding teeth. For a moment, the whole face was visible, and to Marco Valdo, it seemed bewilderingly the face of a cat.
"Right?
They keep me prisoner, they do, those cats. Oh, I'd be glad to leave. What wouldn't I give for a little apartment all my own in a nice, clean, modern building? But I can't go out. They follow me. They block my path. They trip me up."
The voice became a whisper, as if to confide a secret.
"They're afraid I'll sell the lot. They won't leave me, won't allow me. When the builders come to offer me a contract, you should see them, those cats. They get in the way, pull out their claws. They even chased a lawyer off. Once, I had the contract right here. I was about to sign it, and they dived in through the window, knocked over the inkwell, tore up all the pages."
All of a sudden, Marco Valdo remembered the time, the shipping department, the boss. He tiptoed off over the dried leaves as the voice continued to come through the slats of the blind, enfolded in that cloud apparently from the oil of a frying pan.
"He's got to get back to work.
They even scratched me. I still have the scar. All alone here at the mercy of these demons."
Winter came. A blossoming of white flakes decked the branches and capitals and the cat's tails. Under the snow, the dry leaves dissolved into mush. The cats were rarely seen, the cat lovers even less. The packages of fish bones were consigned only to cats who came to the door. Nobody, for quite a while, had seen anything of the Marchesa. No smoke came now from the chimney pot of the villa. One snowy day, the garden was again full of cats, who had returned as if it were spring, and they were meowing as if on a moonlight night. The neighbors realized that something had happened. They went and knocked at the Marchesa's door. She didn't answer. She was dead. In the spring, instead of the garden, there was a huge building site that a contractor had set up. The steam shovels dug down to great depths to make room for the foundations. cement poured into the iron armatures. A very high crane passed beams to the workmen who were making the scaffoldings. But how could they get on with their work? Cats walked along all the planks. They made bricks fall and upset buckets of mortar. They fought in the midst of the piles of sand. When you started to raise an armature, you found a cat perched on top of it, hissing fiercely.
396.
More treacherous pusses climbed onto the masons' backs as if to purr, and there was no getting rid of them. And the birds continued making their nests in all the trestles. The cab of the crane looked like an aviary, and you couldn't dip up a bucket of water that wasn't full of frogs croaking and hopping.
Now, the story has a very, very simple rendering, so let's put this at level one. It's a simple story about a guy who will take his little walk through the city, discover this garden of stubborn cats, meet an old woman, and in the end, the old woman dies. They begin to build their skyscraper in the spot, but these cats refuse to allow them to so easily do it. That's the simple framing of the story. But there's something else going on here, and you can understand now why we focus in our story here on symbolism. Jump down to 2B really quickly. What do these cats symbolize for you? More particularly, what do the cats and the birds and the fish and the frogs all symbolize for you? Some have said that they all somehow represent the world of nature as opposed to the world of humans, and more particularly all of the artificialness and technologically artificialness of the world of humans. And when these two come together and collide, often it's not a real pretty picture, right? Also, of course, there's the old woman. What do you think she symbolizes? What does she represent? Maybe stuck in the middle, a woman who, for example, loves and adores the cats but pretends like she hates them, or in fact, a woman who would like to get rid of the cats but can't get rid of the cats. How do you read this? That part of the story is always fascinating. Of course, seasons matter too, right? So we have the winter, that's when she passes away, and then in the spring we've got this new building that's being attempted, but notice the cats continue to not want to allow for the new building to take place. In other words, let's jump to 2A. This story is going to play around messages of the cohabitation, the challenge of humans and non-human species, life forms, living together, cohabitating. One message of this story is that we all have to find ways to live together, both humans as well as every other life form on this planet. We have to find ways to cohabitate. In the end, nature has its way of letting humans know what nature thinks is the appropriate way to live on this planet. What is for you the 3A text about cats that you love the most? I mentioned McCaffrey, the mystery cat, for those of you that remember that one. What is your favorite film about cats? What's your favorite film or text about animals in general? Finally, it's 3B. Well, if you're a cat lover, you have one kind of reading of this story. If you're a cat hater, you have a different reading of the story. Who are you in relationship to that end of this story? Watch this. I can even ask this at 3A. What were your feelings about these pictures in your book of all these cats? Cat lovers love these pictures. Cat haters are like, this is why I don't like cats. Because, I mean, they got, like, look at that cat on 369 looking at us with, you know, showing its teeth and its claws. I've had students that can't even hardly read the story because of these pictures. They're so like, kind of like, this is why I don't like cats, this is why I don't like cats kind of thing. What is your view of whether it's a good thing or a bad thing that humans and our technologies have found ways to, in many ways, kind of take over the world of nature? Do you like that idea? Are you troubled by that idea? Well, the story goes on and on, right? It's a fascinating study. I hope you enjoyed this little story. Thank you.